Welcome to Insight. Today we're chatting with Martin Fisher, Chief Executive of Kickstart. At Kickstart, Martin developed a range of simple, robust devices that enable poor rural farmers and entrepreneurs to lift themselves out of poverty. Martin has generously agreed to share some of his approach to fixing, and I use the term advisedly, the problem of rural poverty in the developing world, and I'd like to thank you, Martin, for taking the time to join us today.
You're welcome. Thanks. Pleasure to be here.
One of the things that I've always found fascinating is how you deconstruct the problem of poverty in this world, and in particularly in developing countries. Could you just chat a little bit about how you have viewed the problem of poverty and how you've responded to your analysis?
So one of the things that we realized after a number of years of working in Africa, I actually went down there in 1985 and worked for the first 5 years for ActionAid, an organization similar to Save the Children. And when I was there, I did many different programs that I ran. I ran a rural water program. I ran a program helping where we started a couple of workshops and gave farm equipment away to poor farmers. I worked with youth groups and women's groups to help them get into small businesses. And these are the types of things that are typical in development, where you put a water source in a village and you have nice clean water and everybody claps and goes away. Unfortunately, most of them have almost no sustainability. In that
they
you walk away
after a period of time?
Absolutely. You walk away from these things and the water point, for example, will fall apart because nobody looks after it. It's a tragedy of the commons. And I don't own it and you don't own it, so why should I fix it if you're going to use it? And why should you fix it if I'm going to use it? And so Africa is littered with between 50 and 100,000 broken down community water points. The workshops that we started to mass produce farm equipment that we gave away, well, the farmers didn't appreciate it because it wasn't really what they wanted. And much worse than that, there was a guy down the road trying to run a farm equipment production unit as a business. And we put him out of business. And then when the donor funds run out, he's no longer there, we're no longer there, and the community's worse off.
So the donors feel good. They've actually done some work that, when one looks at it, is productive work in terms of developing something, leaving something behind. But the aftermath is just not positive.
It's just not sustainable. Other thing we used to do is we used to help youth and women's groups start small businesses. And we'd set them up in a little business, in a little factory, and donate them some equipment. And as long as we were there holding their hands, the thing would hold together. But the minute we walked away, again, they weren't really entrepreneurs, and the group would fall apart.
Is it because they didn't understand certain aspects of running a business?
No, it's that running a business as a group is very, very difficult. Who owns it? Who's really responsible? Also, they weren't really coming together to run a business. They were coming together because they'd been asked to form a group, and they weren't all that motivated. And the best thing that used to happen once in a while is one of the members, I remember this, would steal the equipment and go start their own business. And of course, we would call him a thief, but actually, in retrospect, he was the only entrepreneur we had in the group. And in the process of doing all this, I also came to a realization that when it comes right down to it, a poor person really only has one need, and that is a way to make more money. Because just like us, they live in a cash economy. And just like us, if they have enough money, they can buy enough food to eat, they can buy farm inputs, they can send their kids to school, they can afford health care, they can get clean water. If they don't have a way to make more money, they literally will never get out of poverty. And so we decided if we're going to tackle poverty, you really have to find a way to create millions and millions of new high-value jobs as quickly as possible.
So is, from the point of view of somebody who is consuming the donations of others, is really what the interest is beyond just being able to put food on the table today, because if one doesn't have food, of course one needs food. But beyond that, is the focus basically is how can I monetize as much of this as possible for today? And so, because there isn't that sustainable thinking that has become part of the consumer's sensibility, it all falls apart.
Yeah, I mean, I think the fundamental thing is just like you and me, these families want nothing more than to be able to survive, have their kids grow up, have a better life, and live a better life. Mm-hmm. And since they live in a cash economy, which they didn't used to, if you go back 25 years, 30 years, you didn't need a lot of cash in Africa, but nowadays you do. And so they need to find a way to make money. They all know that. And they all do whatever they can to make money. In fact, they're already very, very hardworking, very entrepreneurial. And so what they do is they'll go to the big city and try to find a job. And the vast majority of them won't find a job, because there's very few jobs. So instead what they do is they join the informal sector. And what that means is they start a little business of their own. Now if you look at those businesses, the vast majority are doing petty trade. About 60-70% of them are doing petty trade, sitting on the side of the road buying and selling things.
Okay.
And then others are doing carpentry, metalwork, tailoring, food preparation. Very little diversity, all doing the same thing, all competing with each other, making a little bit of money, but the profit margins are very low, so they're not making enough money to get out of poverty. They're making enough money to survive, but not enough to get out of poverty. In the rural areas, people also need money, so they grow their crops, and they turn around and sell their crops, because they need the money more than they need the food, and then they try to buy back food later. And so the problem isn't that people, poor people, don't know how to make some kind of money. They do. But the challenge is they don't really know what business to get into. It's very, very hard for them to identify a really good business opportunity. Because they don't have a lot of education, don't have a lot of exposure. So this is why they all do the same things. And even if they do come up with a new business idea, then it's very, very difficult for them to access the tools and equipment they need in order to make that business viable. And so this is really what Kickstart does. We say if we can solve those two problems, identify businesses that thousands and thousands of people can start with a very small investment and that are going to be very profitable businesses, and then design the tools and equipment they need for those businesses and mass market that equipment to them and tell them, okay, you want to start a business, think about this business, go down to your local shop, buy this equipment and start this business. And so the problem is really that people know they need to make money, they're finding a way to make money, they're just not making enough money to get out of poverty, they're making enough money to stay alive.
So describe a little bit about the Kickstart model.
As I said, the idea is to enable a poor person to start a highly profitable business. And so first of all, what we do is we go out and look at and say, okay, what are the possible businesses that someone could start where they make a small investment anywhere from, say, $50 to a couple hundred dollars
right.
that would be really, really profitable? And having identified that business opportunity, then we design the tools and equipment required. And then we train large-scale factories to do high-quality mass production of this equipment. And then we set up a distribution network. So we have, for example, in East Africa, 450 retail shops that sell our products. And these are existing retail shops. And so now they have shops in every marketplace, every village, every city where they can go and buy this equipment. And now we have to tell these very poor farmers and poor entrepreneurs, hey, you want to start a business? Go down to your local retail shop and buy the equipment. And so we have to do a major, major marketing campaign. And so we get out there and we do live demonstrations on the farms, in the marketplaces, in the villages. We have radio advertisements, billboards, newspaper, competitions. We drive through the rural areas with music playing and doing spraying water on people and making a big noise. So we do a major, major marketing campaign to tell people, hey, here's a brand new technology, something you've never seen before, but something that you can use to start a profitable business. And you can go down to your local shop, you can buy it, you can buy the spare parts right there in your local village, and you can use this and you can start a business that's going to be very profitable.
What type of products do you sell?
So we started with machines for making low-cost building materials. So for example, a machine for making very strong building blocks out of soil and cement, compressed at a high pressure. And then we got into a machine for making cooking oil out of sunflower seed, where it's a human-powered press and you put sunflower seed in, and you get high-value cooking oil and you get animal feed as the byproduct. And both these businesses, very, very profitable businesses, but a little bit complicated businesses.
And they also seem to be culturally, economically in alignment with what's on the ground. People are using building materials. People are familiar with oils and livestock feed and the raw materials.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. If you're gonna start a business, you need to first of all identify who your customers are gonna be.
Right.
And for a poor person, their customers are going to be other poor people because that's who their neighbors are, that's who they know. It's very hard for a poor person to start a business now suddenly selling to wealthy people in America
right.
or even wealthy people in the city when they've never been to the city. And so absolutely, these are products that these businesses are producing have to be things they can sell in their local community and things that are already understood. And so that's why everybody needs to build a house. So building materials make sense, cooking oil makes sense, they all buy cooking oil. And we had a hay baler. For example, for baling hay. Now, it turns out when you're very poor and you live in a small plot of land, you still want to keep a cow because you want to milk it, and that's a great little business, selling the milk. But you can't really let your cow graze because you don't have enough land and you're growing your crops there, so you have to buy hay every year. In fact, you have to buy hay every week. And the only people who could bale hay were a couple of the large-scale farmers who had very fancy hay balers.
Right.
So we said, okay, let's design a small-scale hay baler. Now a small-scale farmer can grow hay, you can bale it, and it would be a business baling hay for people, and then they can sell the hay, farmers can buy it, feed their cow, and have a dairy. So you always have to look at the whole economic package when you're looking for a new business. And then we asked ourselves, okay, these businesses are nice, the oil press, the block press, the hay baler, but they're a little bit expensive. These machines are about, you know, $300, $400. The business is a little bit complicated to run. And we asked ourselves, what business can your average African start? Now in Africa, 80% of the poor people are poor rural farmers. In fact, worldwide, almost one-third of the people in the world are poor rural farmers. And so that means you're a farmer, you live on a small plot of land, anywhere from maybe half an acre up to a few acres if you're a little bit wealthier. And that's really your one asset, that little plot of land. And your number one skill is basic farming. And so if you're going to start a business, it's best to use your asset and your skill. And the best thing a poor rural farmer can do is move away from rain-fed agriculture, where they wait for the rain, which comes once a year, or if they're lucky, twice a year, and they all grow the same crop at the same time, and they all harvest at the same time,
right.
The price goes through the floor. Move away from that, and move to commercial irrigated agriculture. Because now with irrigation, all of a sudden you can grow crops throughout the year, you can grow high-value crops, you can get high yields, and you can bring them out when nobody else has any crops on the market. And so there's about 6 or 8 months where the price is very, very high. So suddenly you can make a lot of money and you can get a steady daily income from irrigation. And so we said, okay, what about small-scale irrigation pumps? And you can get petrol pumps in some of these places, but they're very expensive and there's no gas in the rural areas.
They break down and you don't have spare parts.
The minute they break down, you're in trouble. And there's no electricity, so electric pumps don't make sense. And so this is why we said, okay, let's develop a line of human-powered irrigation pumps. And these we call the moneymaker pumps, because a poor person really only cares about one thing, making more money. And there's a little Stairmaster machine, our best-selling pump, called the Super Moneymaker.
Uh-huh.
Like a little take-home Stairmaster machine. And you walk back and forth on it, and you have a hose pipe that goes down into a well or into a pond, and it can pull water from a well as deep as 30 feet and pull it up. And then you have another hose pipe coming out of the other side, which is like a garden hose.
Mm-hmm.
And there you can spray water, you can push it up a hill, you can put it through sprinklers, and you can irrigate 2 acres of land with this little thing. And it's $100 retail.
That's incredible. It looks like two coffee cans. I've seen one of them. They look like two coffee cans with a piston in it. And it looks like a little stairmaster, you know, rocking back and forth.
Exactly. And you got two cylinders, two pistons, and on each stroke, one piston is sucking the water in, and the other one is pushing it out.
Uh-huh.
So you get a continuous flow of water going out of the hose pipe.
It looks like you can almost hit it with a sledgehammer and it would still be okay. It looks quite robust.
Yeah, well, you have to design it to be very robust because it's going to be used miles from the nearest road, miles from the nearest repair shop. We also design it so you don't need any tools to repair it or maintain it.
Oh, really?
So you can take it apart just with your hands. You don't need a screwdriver. You don't need a hammer because a poor farmer doesn't have a screwdriver or a hammer.
Mm-hmm.
They only have maybe a machete and a hoe. Those are their only two tools. And so you have to be able to take apart the pump by yourself with your hands. Has to be very lightweight because they're carrying it to their farm. It has to be extremely durable. There are a couple of spare parts which can be replaced by hand, but they're available in the local shop where they bought the pump, so they can always go back to town and get the spare parts. With this little pump, you can irrigate 2 acres, and on average, farmers are making $1,000 extra profit per year.
From $1,000 extra profit, so that's
right.
Not $1,000 revenue, it's $1,000 extra profit.
Exactly.
What is the income of these farmers before versus after?
So typically these farmers before are living on anywhere with their whole family, and say a family of five, living on anywhere between, you know, $400 a year for the family and maybe up to $2,000 a year per family. So you add an extra $1,000 on, even if you were at $2,000 a year, it's a 50% increase in your income is very, very significant. And obviously if you're at $400, you're suddenly getting four times your income. And so it dramatically changes their lives. It literally takes them from below the poverty line into the middle class. And,
mm-hmm.
and for the first time, they no longer have to worry about the basics. They don't have to worry about feeding their family, don't have to worry about sending their kids to primary school or basic health care or having a house to live in or basic clothes. They can afford all that stuff. And then most importantly, they can have some money left over to invest in the future. And really, if you think about poverty, in some ways, that's a very good definition of being out of poverty, where you're no longer worried about survival, and now you can plan for the future. So what do they do with that extra money? They send their kids on to secondary school, on to college, they build a new house, they buy a cow, they start another business, they buy a maize mill, they build rental housing to rent out. Usually it's just sort of the first step out of poverty, and then you'll find if you come back and visit these families 3-4 years later, you'll discover they have a couple other businesses, they're now making, you know, $4,000-$5,000 a year, and it's really saying, okay, they were very, very poor farmers, this is their first step by taking that very large leap. As a first step, now they can really get on the track of getting out.
And by increasing agricultural yields, you're also addressing the issue of endemic boom and bust agricultural cycles.
Absolutely.
In which yields fall dramatically and there's starvation and there's aid that's required and so on. And so you're ameliorating that.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, a couple of things happen. One, of course, is that if everybody grows the same crop at the same time, at that moment, you can't sell the crop because your neighbors have it, so they're not going to pay you anything for it. The price goes through the floor. In Africa, there's not enough infrastructure to transport all that crop to the main markets in the cities. There's not infrastructure to store it.
Right.
And so a lot of it actually goes to waste. And if you do sell it, you sell it at a very low price. And then 3 months later, everybody's hungry.
Right.
And the prices are very high.
And if there's any kind of pest that comes in or insect or something that affects the crop yields, it's a complete disaster.
That's right. And then, of course, with climate change, one of the big challenges we have now is that you can no longer rely on the rains. And so, for example, in Kenya right now, we have a major drought where really 3 rainy seasons have been missed. And if you don't have irrigation, you're lost. You lost 3 harvests with the rains. But if you can irrigate, of course, people can bring out crops throughout the year. So if we think about what are the real things we need to do in order to increase food security in Africa, you can talk about improved seeds, improved fertilizer to increase the yields, and certainly those are very important things to do. However, simply increasing the yields of the rain-fed harvest is in some ways going to exacerbate the same problem, because suddenly you're going to have even more crops at a time where you don't have the infrastructure to store it or transport it. But with irrigation as the first step, now you can spread out that production. And then as we develop the infrastructure, we can bring in the improved seeds and fertilizer.
And diversify your crops.
And diversification, of course, is very important also.
In terms of how you get these devices out, you don't give them away.
No, we don't.
Tell us a little bit about why you don't just give them away.
So it turns out giving things away has a lot of disadvantages. To begin with, it's very unfair, because if I come into a community, how do I decide, okay, you get one, but you don't get one? Somebody's got to make that decision. And the minute you have to make a decision like that, of course, it can be corrupted. So it's not going to be a fair decision. Turns out it's also very expensive to give things away, because to give things away, you actually have to set up and establish a network where you actually have a distribution network, where you go out and you work with the villagers and figure out who gets them and who doesn't get them. And that's not a very cheap thing to do. But much more than that, it's completely unsustainable, because I give you a pump today, and then, you know, 18 months from now you need a spare part. Well, you're going to come back to me and say, hey, Martin, I need a spare part. I'm long gone, and there's nowhere to buy the spare part. Or your neighbor actually sees what you're doing with a pump, and they want a pump. Well, they didn't get lucky enough to get one. They'll never get one. And then on top of that, it completely kills your dignity, because nobody likes to be a beggar. And nobody likes to say, oh, please, you know, give me something and I'll use it. And also, when you get something, you don't really appreciate it. And we all know that. We take we get given a gift for Christmas, and, you know, half of them we put in the drawer and we never look at again. On the other hand, if we have some skin in the game, if we go out and make a choice, I'm going to buy something, you're much more likely to use it yourself. And so there's just many good reasons why giving things away doesn't make sense. Now, there are times when people are starving, when you have a massive drought or famine, when, of course, people need to be given food to stay alive. But in the longer term, giving things away is completely, really kills development. It kills the local marketplace. We've had places where people have come along and given away a lot of our pumps, for example, and all of a sudden our local retail shops can't sell the pumps because somebody set the price of the pump at zero, and now the farmers are going to wait around and say, okay, wait till they come back and give me one. Well, that's not going to happen because they ran out of the money for giving.
So all of a sudden your distribution network decides they're not going to stock the pumps, they're not going to sell the pumps spare parts and so on and so forth because
they can't make money because somebody's giving them away. Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So you're selling these pumps to these rural farmers who don't have much capital. I suppose that buying a $100 pump is going to require a lot of thinking and a lot of consideration.
Exactly.
And how is that process supported, or is the process supported? Is it the case where you set up shop, you make sure that your local distributor has a pump and people can just sort of worry about whether they buy it or not? Is it, are we letting, allowing the consumer to sort of fend for themselves, or is there, you would refer to education processes, is that part of your, is that really almost your sales process?
Yeah, so it's a bit of both. Absolutely, we set up a distribution network, and the pumps are now in these local shops. The local shopkeepers have actually bought the pumps on credit. They get 45 days credit, so now they have them on the shelf. Now, they can't sell this pump because you're selling to a farmer who's never seen a pump like this in their life. It's a brand new piece of technology. These are the very, very poorest, hardest to reach, and most risk-averse buyers in the whole world. An average farmer in Africa will basically live on their farm. They live on their small farm. They only come to the local marketplace, you know, maybe once every 2 or 3 weeks for an hour or two. They only come to the local town, you know, maybe once or twice a year. If they have a radio, which many of them do, they don't always have batteries for the radio. So even the radio they don't have every day. And so it's very, very hard to reach them and convince them to buy a brand new, never before seen, big ticket item. And so we have to do a massive amount of education and marketing. And so this is where we go out and we do these demonstrations on the farm. So we actually go out there and we have staff who go out and go to a farm, have that farmer invite their neighbors around, and we do a demonstration of the pump. We demonstrate on the market days, in the marketplace. Then we do use radio advertisements, we do use billboards. We take pickup trucks and drive through the rural areas. We have pumping competitions on the market day where we mount a couple of pumps on the back of a pickup truck, and it's like a game show, and people come up and compete. And so all sorts of promotion methods to tell people, hey, here is a pump, something you've never seen before, but this can drastically change your life. Now, $100, like you say, is a little expensive. So we also have a much cheaper pump. We have a $34 pump that retails at $34. That pump can irrigate 1.25 acres. It looks like a hand pump, a little bit like a bicycle pump. But instead of a bicycle pump, which you would use your arms, and your arms get very fatigued, you know, within about 1 minute, you're very tired. With this pump, it's pivoted, and so you can actually do what we call, it's called a hip pump, and it's sort of a hip motion, sort of a dancing motion, where you can do that all day long. And again, it can pull water from a well 30 feet deep, and it can push the water through a hose pipe, just like a garden hose pipe. And like I say, irrigate 1.25 acres if you work it for 3 or 4 hours a day. Now, even $34 is a little expensive, but it is affordable. If people are really convinced about the value. And so just like with any new product in the world, in the beginning, first of all, you have to make people aware that it even exists. Right. So if you think about us with cell phones, I mean, cell phones, I think, were invented in 1978. And we probably didn't actually hear about them until, you know, maybe 83 or 84. And we weren't convinced that they were useful for us to actually own sometime until the early 90s. And maybe we didn't actually buy one until, who knows, the mid to late 90s. So it takes time for anybody to be excited about a new technology. I mean, same thing if you think about PCs,
right,
or if you think about how long it took us to be convinced to buy things on the internet. It took 10 years just to change the way we go shopping.
Yes.
You know? And it took American farmers, the wealthiest farmers in the world, 20 years to adopt hybrid crops, hybrid seeds, even though they were going to increase their yield by a factor of 2. It took them 20 years to be convinced. And those are the wealthiest farmers in the world. So now we're selling to the very, very poorest farmers in the world. It takes a huge amount of marketing effort to convince them to buy. In terms of, can somebody buy a pump on credit? It would seem that if they could get credit, at least after they've decided they want to buy, they're aware of the pump, they've decided it's useful for them, they make the decision to buy, at that point offering credit would be useful. We don't offer credit, and the reason is because nobody really knows how to do microfinance in rural East Africa. And the reason for that is because farmers live on their farms very isolated, and they're scattered all over the place. So the cost of going to meet that farmer is very expensive. And so microfinance, when people live in urban or peri-urban areas, or they live in a village, is very easy because you just go door to door and you set up a microfinance group and you can make the loans, you can collect the loans. But if you give somebody a pump and they go off to their rural farm miles off the road, it's very expensive to go collect the money. So we're looking into ways of doing layaway, for example, where now farmers can pay a little bit at a time, so really micropayments, because poor farmers, it's very hard for them to save any money. And you can imagine, you live in a small mud hut, right, with a big family, and there's nowhere to save money. You don't have a bank, so you literally have to, you know, hide it under your mattress. And, well, it's a little hut. Somebody's going to find it, and there's a big draw on money. So savings is very, very tough. And so the poor are actually willing to pay people to look after their money. So if you do a layaway program, you can actually have a small fee, which would cover the costs, and now the farmers effectively start making small payments, and when they're fully paid for a pump, as a micro savings and micro payment, then they can take the pump.
It's very interesting when you talk about rural farmers, because there's a huge amount of respect that's embedded in what you're talking about. You're respecting these individuals, these entrepreneurs, as business people. You're respecting them as having the analytical capability of making these decisions, of thinking through concepts like return on investment, which $100 is a huge investment, mm-hmm. huge investment. $34 can be a huge investment. So there's a huge amount of respect that seems to be embedded in your model.
Absolutely. I mean, I think one of the things that we do very differently than many aid organizations is we don't see the poor as victims. We see the poor as hardworking, dynamic individuals who are trying to look after their family and have a better life. And all they need is an option. All they need is an opportunity in order to do that. And you give them an opportunity, and they're going to grab that opportunity, and they're going to run with it.
And you're not even giving them the opportunity. You're basically
making it available.
We have technology. It might be useful. We'll tell you about it. Make the decision. If you make the decision, then you can buy this technology at a reasonably affordable price, a price within your reach. But you're not actually giving them anything.
That's right. All we're doing is we're saying, here are some options. Here's some opportunities to get out of poverty. You do the rest. And the reason we know this is going to work is because the poor are already starting businesses. All of them are already finding ways to make money. You know, and they're not just sitting there dying, because literally in Africa, if you don't have a way to make money, you have to die. You can't live without money, just like here. And so they are finding ways to stay alive. They are finding ways to get a few pennies. And we're saying, okay, well, here's a possibility to make a lot more money. And all you need to do is know about it. Yeah, you need to convince them that it's a good one, because it's brand new, they've never seen it. But once they're convinced, they'll grab these things, they'll buy them, and they'll start these very, very profitable businesses, and then continue to grow. I mean, one thing I always notice, you know, is if you're trying to tackle poverty in Africa, in many ways it's very easy. And why do I say it's easy? Well, when 70% of the people are dirt poor, 70% of the entrepreneurs and doctors and lawyers and CEOs are dirt poor. Now, they're just like the doctors and lawyers and CEOs and entrepreneurs we have here. It's just they don't have the same education, the same opportunity, and they're not waiting around for a handout. You know, none of us are. They're waiting around for an opportunity. You give it to them, they're gonna climb right out of poverty. When you're tackling the last, 10 or 15% of the poor, as we might be in America, for example, yeah, then you've got different challenges. Now it's a more difficult challenge. But when 70% of the people are poor, it's easy.
Talk a little bit about how you've evolved, first ApproTEC and now KickStart, as an organization, which I found to be very fascinating. You have described and you've implied that you have a sales force and you have a force that trains people. There's a marketing function. But talk a little bit about how you are organized, where your staff is located, and so on.
So we actually started the organization way back in 1991 in Kenya. And this was myself and Nick Moon. And we'd been working together at ActionAid and got frustrated and realized that what we were doing wasn't really having a lot of impact. And we decided what we have to do is develop business possibilities and business opportunities for very poor people and the right technology and get it out there. And this was, in those days, not a very popular thing to say. And we were actually asked to leave ActionAid. and so we said, okay, we haven't done anything wrong. We'll leave in 6 months. And in that time, we managed to raise a little bit of money as a matching grant in order to start what we called ApproTEC in those days, which later became KickStart. And of course, a matching grant is nice, but if you have nothing to match it with, you don't have any money. So for the first year or so, we matched it with our salaries, and meaning we didn't get paid salaries, and we now had some money to hire some other people. Then we had a major opportunity because it was a lot of violence in Somalia. There was a civil war in Somalia in 92, 93. And about 350,000 Somali refugees poured into the desert in northeastern Kenya as refugees. And it turned out the Somalis were unique in the history of refugees, that when you build a refugee camp, what you have to do is you provide housing, so you put up tents. You have to provide food, so you bring in a lot of food. You have to provide water, so you put in some deep boreholes usually and some big tanks. And you have to provide sanitation. And normally, some refugees would have shared toilets. And you would build some pit latrines and one for every few hundred people. But the Somalis were unique, and they refused to use communal toilets. Probably very wisely, because if you're a nomad or a pastoralist, you don't use a communal place to go to the toilet. And so we'd been playing around with a very low-cost technology for making low-cost pit latrines. And we ended up becoming a UNHCR implementing partner and putting in 100,000 pit latrines. We trained all the other agencies, so in all the refugee camps in Kenya. And so this was a multi-million dollar contract. And the reason we did it is because we needed the 6.5% overhead so we could match our funding matching grant from DFID and actually continue with Kickstart. So even once you have a good idea, even once you start an organization, it's actually a struggle to get going because you need to get the money. And then we got back to developing, as I said, the block press and the oil press. And in those days, we really didn't understand the marketing challenge. We really thought that if you build a better build a better mousetrap, people will come to it. And so we thought, we're going to make these great technologies, which people can make money with. We're going to put them out on the street on a bunch of places, and people will just come and buy them. Well, that didn't happen. People saw these things. They're like, what in the world is that? What has it got to do with me? And so we realized the importance of marketing. And we started to, over the years, then become more and more convinced that actually the most important job we have is the marketing and sales.
So at this point, you and Nick were both living in Kenya?
So we were both living in Kenya, yeah. So I lived in Kenya for 17 years.
You designed some of these devices. You put them out. You got them into stores. And nothing happened. It basically fell flat. It was like knocking an anvil off a table. There was no bounce.
These things are just sitting there, yeah. And at that time, we also believed that the best way to do this was to have very small workshops, local workshops, be producing these devices, because we thought then we would create some employment in those workshops. But it also turns out that having a small workshop manufacture a high-quality device is very difficult. They don't have the management skills. They don't have the working capital. They don't have the capacity to have good quality control. And they don't have the sort of workflow to make it work. And so then we ended up going to larger workshops and larger factories. And finally, we worked with the biggest factories in Kenya. And today, we actually mass produce in China because we're selling, last year we sold over 30,000 of our pumps in the last 12 months. And so that was another one of the lessons we learned, is that, really sort of localized small-scale manufacturing doesn't make sense when you want a product to really take off.